Is a divinely appointed imam considered a parallel power besides Allah? Have the divinely revealed books mention or indicate the coming of a Messiah who will bring justice to this corrupted world? Is the existence of Allah's representative on earth a necessity? Any human needs blood to continue his life, and the existence of blood is necessary in every single moment of life. Is this any way independent of God? Or has God created this as a necessity for humans and has fulfilled it? Similarly, is the function of the Imam over the universe the same as the function of blood to the human life? Similar questions will be tackled with evidences from the traditions of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, and verses from the Holy Quran to develop an answer whether the awaited Imam exists or yet to exist. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to our new show, The Awaited Apostle, with me, your host Ahmed Ali. Respected viewers, welcome back to our new show, The Awaited Apostle, with me, your host, Ahmed Ali. The questions I mentioned will be answered in today's program with my dear guest, Sayyid Muzaffar Al-Qazwini. So let's welcome. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's good to see you again. On a happy occasion, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. For that reason, I would like to congratulate you. For you are the descendant of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam.
Allah bless you.
Allah khalikum. Sayyidina, we have gathered today to discuss the existence of Imam Mahdi Abdullah Farooq Sharif. May Allah hasten his reappearance. I would like to mention a quote from a book I read from the opposite side, which claim, I'll read it, the opponents of Shia protest that although Shia consider the Imam necessary in order to explain the injunctions of religions and to guide the people, the occultation of the Imam is the negation of the very purpose for an Imam in occultation, who cannot reach mankind, who cannot be reached by mankind, cannot be in any way beneficial or effective. The opponents argue that if God wills to bring forth an Imam to reform mankind, He is able to create him at a specific time or necessary moment and does not need to create him thousands of years before. The question is, when people come to ask, the question is, some people refute the existence of the Imam. They say he's not yet to be born. Now, such people also disprove, when we bring traditions from Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, disprove our argument from Ahlul Bayt. What does the Quran have to say about this issue?
Inshallah, through this episode, we'll prove through holy verses, through the Quran, that the existence of a vicegerent and a proof of Allah through every era, every day, every year, until the day of judgment is necessary. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his universe. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned for everything in existence.
Definitely.
That from the time of the existence of man, there was a vicegerent and a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the first moment of being until the last moment before the angel Israfil blows in his horn and the day of judgment or the day of reckoning appears upon this realm. So, if as you mentioned, that their theory is why do you claim that he was born? What's the
evidence
that he was born? And even with evidence, why is it important to prove that he was born? It's been 1,200 years that we have not seen him, we have not heard of him. You as Shia, 12ers, the Ithna Asharis claim that he was born and then he went into Ghaiba. And for the past 12 centuries that he has been away from mankind. But them, on the other hand, they say that, no, we don't say that, or we don't say that we don't believe in his theory, or that we don't believe that there will be a vicegerent at the end of time when the world is diluted and painted by injustice for the Messiah, the Mahdi, to come and to bring peace once again to Mother Earth and to this universe. But why is it important that we Twelvers, Ithna Asharis, carry this specific ideology, that we claim that he was born and the world cannot be without a vicegerent for 12 centuries, or from the time of Imam Al-Hasan ibn Ali, Muhammad ibn Imam Al-Hasan al-Askari, till today. They say that, you know, after the time of Imam Hasan al-Askari, then the Ithna Asharis did not have any more imams. It is negotiable whether he had a son or he did not have a son. So, putting the hadiths aside, narratives aside, do we have proof from the Quran that this world cannot be left alone without a vicegerent? As the hadith says, لَوْلَا الْحُجَّةِ لَسَاخَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِأَهْلِهَا, that without the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without the vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this world will perish. And he is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept everything together. Now, before we get into the verses, can we find something similar in the life of other messengers or prophets or proofs of Allah, representatives of Allah, that their birth was concealed, or the pregnancy of their mothers were concealed? When they carried their children, their children being prophets or messengers or representatives of Allah, was their carriage and their birth concealed from the tyrants of their time, or the time being, you know, what pressured them and what they feared for? And did we see this only in the life of prophets, or did we see this in the life of certain important individuals like kings who, you know, hid the birth of their new son, fearing that he would be hurt or killed by his elder brothers who wanted to take the throne, or those who wanted to take position after the king? And we've seen this throughout history, especially, you know, if we go back thousands and thousands of years, when, you know, this world was ruled by dynasties and kings, and they would inherit father to son, and so on and so forth. But even today, within our own societies, we've all heard of people who get married, a second marriage, and they do not, you know, make it into a public issue, because they fear of problems with their first siblings, with their first family. And this is something normal. And we've witnessed such, you know, and encountered such things in our lives when, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it permissible for a man to get married to more than one wife. But, you know, within society, of what people say about him, and so on and so forth, fearing that his children from his first wife or first wife would be unhappy, he does not, you know, reveal his second marriage, or that he had child from a second marriage. Mm-hmm. And I personally know of two, three different individuals who, you know, they had been married a second marriage for 15, 16 years, and after 15, 16 years, their first wife and children mm-hmm. barely found out that he had gotten married and wow. he had kids. Wow, so even within our own societies, you know, it's logical that some people do this, and it's not something that we have not heard of yeah. or something that's not, you know, absurd. It's heard of and it happens in everyday society.
And that's for a specific issue that they have or a specific...
Yes, it's, you know, it's whether, you know, he fears for the life of his children, mm-hmm. for his new child, for the life of his new wife, mm-hmm. you know, when Ibrahim got married, you saw how it was with his first wife and yes. second wife, you know. Yeah. So since then, men have been taking that as a lesson. Uh-huh. You know, he doesn't want his second wife being thrown in Mecca, yeah, in barren land. Yeah. So speaking of Ibrahim, when we come to the story of Ibrahim, alayhi afdal as-salatu was-salam, Ibrahim was born in Babylon. At the time of a vicious king by the name of Namrud. Mm-hmm. Namrud, who, you know, historians say that at the time of Ibrahim, only four kings ruled the realms. You know, something similar to, you know, what we find in this HBO series, Game of Thrones, where there are seven kingdoms. But at the time of Ibrahim, there were four kingdoms. Two kings were noble, which were Solomon, the son of David, and then Dhul-Qarnayn, and who were two noble kings, and Namrud, and another king who were not noble. They were, you know, after this world and its desires, and they were tyrants. Mm-hmm. So at the time of Namrud, his ministers came to him, those who would study the stars, and through the stars they would come and they were magicians, sorcerers. They would they came and told Namrud that through the stars we have come to a conclusion that within this time, within these days, a child will be born in the city of Babylon, and this child's name is Ibrahim, and this child will destroy your empire. Wow. Through this child will come the end of your empire. So what Namrud did, and this is something that we often only hear about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Moses, peace be upon him, that Fir'aun, you know, gathered the women and he killed over 100,000 women in labor and so on and so forth. But first, let's finish the story of Ibrahim. So Ibrahim, same thing, Namrud gathered all the women who had a pregnancy. And historians say he gathered them within his castle. And whichever woman who, you know, her pregnancy would appear upon her, they would cut open her stomach, kill the child or kill the mother. So they took precaution that this child is not born and the kingdom of Namrud does not come to an end. Mm-hmm. So by the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah concealed the pregnancy of Ibrahim alayhi afdal as-salatu was-salam, and his mother gave birth to him to a point that she, you know, it was only her that knew she was pregnant. And when her husband asked her if she was pregnant, first she denied him until she gave birth. She gave birth to Ibrahim in a cave, and she kept him in that cave for 15 months. And she would visit him once a day, and she would see Ibrahim sucking on his thumb. And as hadith say that through his thumb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him his sustenance because the mother could not get to him and breastfeed him and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And then after these 15 months, way that Ibrahim would age is much different than how we age in 15 months, and this is how it is with almost every single prophet or messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after the 15 months, he comes out of the cave, and that's when the story in the Quran starts, that he looks at the moon and he says, "Is this my God?" And when the moon disappears, he says, "No, my God cannot disappear," and so on and so forth. So this is the story of Ibrahim. His pregnancy, or the pregnancy of his mother was concealed due to, you know, the injustice and tyranny of his time. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to bring a representative and a person that represents him in this world, and to guide the sons of Adam. And same thing with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. When the sorcerers or magicians of Fir'aun, the Pharaoh told him that a child will be born, and through this child your kingdom and throne will come to an end. And same thing, his mother's pregnancy was concealed until she gave birth to him, and she placed him in a small little basket. She placed him in the Nile River, and so on and so forth, so Fir'aun does not find him and does not kill him. So this is something very normal. If we look at the lives of and as believers, whether you're a Muslim, a Jew, or a Christian, you must believe in this. Because we, as monotheistic believers, we all believe what happened to Abraham and Moses.
Yes. But if we want to connect these two stories to Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, I know that there's a very famous story that also the Imam's birth was also concealed from even his close relatives, uncles.
So why do I mention this? Why do I mention this? Because exactly the same thing with the pregnancy of the mother of Imam Mahdi, Narjis alayha afdal as-salati was-salam, it was also concealed, because you have to know the Imam was given birth to at a time where Bani Abbas, the sons of Abbas, were in the peak of their tyranny.
Yes.
Where, you know, they knew nothing besides bloodshed. And especially when it came to the lives and the blood of the Imams and the descendants of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and the proofs and vicegerents of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus you see, his father was placed in a military camp. He was not allowed to leave, depart this military camp. And they lived a very, you know, secluded life between soldiers and generals and guards, day and night. They could not get to their companions, they could not get to their family members. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already made his decision that the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must be born.
And the reason behind
he must be given
that,
birth to. Because he is the 12th Amir, he is the 12th Khalifa that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alih mentioned in his hadith throughout the Muslim heritage, whether it's Shia or Sunni books of thought. So there is no difference between you know, what was happening in the time of Musa or Ibrahim or the 12th Imam, the Messiah, Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu farajahu al-sharif. So before we get into the ayahs, I wanted to clarify this issue that we should not see it as something, you know, absurd. Because through, you know, this religion and monotheistic religions, this has to be accepted. Sometimes a pregnancy is concealed due to, you know, the tyranny of the time.
Yes. And one of the reasons that they did that is, subhanAllah, somehow the Abbasids were actually somewhat smart. They knew that, you know, through the Quran, they had their own ways of understanding.
No, and every the Abbasi kings would send, you know, women into the house of Imam al-Hasan al-Askari to check every single lady that lived in the house of Imam al-Hasan al-Askari to see if she was pregnant or not. They would check every woman every day. So, you know, imagine what type of life they had at the time. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides something,
no one can stand in the way of Allah.
If He says for something to be, then that thing will be done.
Subhanallah, and that's what it happened. They knew that if...
As the Quran mentions.
As the Quran mentions, and they knew if this baby was to be born, because they count 12, Imam the 12th will be the one who will, you know, end injustice and corruption. They'll reign will end on his hands. That's why they kept an eye on Imam al-Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam. But if we want to come to the verses I mentioned, that, you know, somewhat...
This was exactly one of the reasons why they placed him in a military camp.
Mm-hmm.
To keep an eye on him 24 hours a day. 24/7 there is surveillance upon this man, because they know through the traditions of the Prophet, through this man comes the Messiah. Through this man comes an end to tyranny. Through this man and his lineage, his son, comes, you know, peace throughout the whole world. So what do? When we want to rule, we want power, we want to keep everything within our own hands, we keep this man under 24-hour surveillance.
Mm-hmm.
We check every single maid, every single wife on a distant, you know, call. Women are checking upon them every day, who goes in, who goes out. So same thing that happened in the time of Ibrahim or the time of Musa, alayhum afdhal as-salati was-salam, when Namrud or Fir'aun gathered all the women in their castles, and they would check which woman was pregnant or not. And the women that were pregnant were killed or butchered, or their stomachs were ripped open.
Wow, that's very graphic. I mean, but for the sake of the argument, we have approximately 2 minutes before we go into a break. But Sayyidina, one of the verses from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran that I would like to mention is, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْدِرْ وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, you are not but a warner, and for every nation exists a guide. And what are the names of the Imams? We did not go into the titlements of the Imam because they're famous, everyone talks about them. But the main idea is the existence of the Imam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and for every nation there's a guide. For Ibrahim alayhi salam, his era, he was the guide. Moses was the guide. Prophet Muhammad, the Imams, the Prophets, they were the guide. But one of the entitlements of Imam al-Mahdi is al-Hadi, al-Mahdi, the guidance, the one who guides the nation. So is this verse, is Imam al-Mahdi included in this verse as the Had?
Inshallah. Before we get into this verse, and inshallah, the verses that I will mention, yes, the Imam is part of this verse.
Mm-hmm.
Inshallah, I will bring the exact translation or the exact hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi upon this verse. And we will go through every single verse that we can declare as a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not leave a nation without a vicegerent or proof upon this earth. Upon mankind.
Mm-hmm. So inshallah, we'll do that after a short break, Sayyidina, if you
inshallah.
Will. Inshallah. So respected viewers, we're going to continue this discussion, the existence of Imam al-Mahdi, ajallahu farajhu al-Sharif, but after this short break, so stay tuned.
ابر عاشقی داره میباره آره داره میباره نم نم و آروم و بی صدا میونه کوچه ها میزنه باز بارون به شیشه نم نم آدمو آروم و بی صدا میونه کوچه ها میزنه باز بارون به شیشه هر نفس زیده این آسمون قصه عشقمون مثل قدیم ها زنده میشه تا دلا رها میشه سائره خدا میشه زمان آواره شد ملک فلک بیچاره شد همه در نظاره شد که عالمی به شور و شیمه شب تولد حسینه که عالمی به شور و شیمه شب تولد حسینه تو خدا میدونه نقش سینه پیر و جوونه هر تپش دلم داره میخونه آره داره میخونه عمریه بوی نسیم تو سوی حریم تو میبره قلب عاشقا رو عمریه بوی نسیم تو سوی حریم تو میبره قلب عاشقا تو نازنین منو قابل بدون آقای مهربون ببینم ایوونه تلا تو راه تو سعادت آرزوم شهادت
The divinely appointed imam directs human spirituality and human life and orients the inner aspect of human action towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for that reason, his physical appearance or absence has no effect in this manner. Imam is the representative of Allah, Khalifatullah, on earth and his vicegerent. Before the break, we talked about the concealing of the pregnancy of special prophets and imams who were the pregnancy of their mothers were concealed due to the situation that they were in by the tyrants of their time, and similar with our 12th Imam. But after the break, we promised to talk about the verses which indicate and prove the existence of Imam Mahdi Ajallah Faraj al-Sharif. May Allah hasten his reappearance. Sayyidina, welcome back. I know that you're very sick, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the sake of Imam Mahdi, heal your sickness. But Sayyidina, speaking of Khilafah, the proof of Allah or the authority of Imam Mahdi Ajallah Faraj al-Sharif upon the universes, there are or are there any evidences that prove his Khilafah? In other words, what does the Quran and the traditions of Shia and non-Shia state regarding the Imam's authority?
Well, before we recite the verse through the Holy Quran, something we need to elaborate on is that the Quran says that every time a man exists or man exists, and them being mukallaf, basically, those who the religions and commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upheld upon them, there has to be a khalifa, proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala existent. Now, whether it's the 12th Imam or just a plain, simple khalifa, for us, Ithna Asharis, we say it's the 12th Imam. But we ask other schools of thought and we ask other religions that who is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to represent you and to represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this universe. And It cannot be a normal human being. As for us, we don't say our maraji' or scholars are the khulafa, the khalifas that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed as a proof or a connection between this earth and the heavens. Mm-hmm. No. We say that this is the job of the imam, the job of a prophet, divinely chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it cannot be a pope, it cannot be, you know, Dalai Lama, or it cannot, no, it has to be divinely, he has to be divinely chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Definitely.
Meaning that he cannot be any different from Moses or Jesus in his teachings that were given to him directly by his Lord, directly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and God. So this is what we have to clarify before we get into our subject. That today, if we go to other schools of thought, they lack this ingredient. They don't have someone that represents them divinely and is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except the Ithna Asharis, except the 12ers that say Imam al-Mahdi is the representative and the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this universe. So through the verse that I will read, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةٌ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after He created the angels, He told them that after your creation, I created Adam and placed him as a vicegerent on earth to represent me, to be my representative. Now here, those who do not agree with us say that this was only specialized in Adam. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only calls upon Adam as a khalifa. But this is not true. When we have other verses that also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the same position to the Prophet David, to Prophet David in the holy verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatun fil ard. So this same position was given to Dawood. So immediately, you know, their accusation that this was only given to Adam is broken and demolished. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Adam and David both as khulafa, as vicegerents and proofs upon mankind on this earth. And when we go to the first verse, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentions the word khalifa, we have to go through the words in the holy verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa, that I am placing a vicegerent on earth to represent me. Now, if we go to the Arabic language, we see that this is a continuation. There's a continuation that there will always be a khalifa representing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the time that Adam existed, from the time man existed upon this earth until the day of judgment. So it cannot be specialized only in Adam, peace be upon him, as we mentioned the verse in Dawood alayhi afdalus salati wassalam. And it cannot be, you know, merely just the human being, that I'm placing human beings to represent me on earth because they do not carry, you know, the criteria to be a khalifa, a vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the Holy Quran says about some human beings, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا, that some human beings are just like cattle, or sometimes even worse than cattle in being, you know, lost and misguided and not knowing what to do when it comes to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. That, you know, their senses of intellect are basically not there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never place a representative with such characteristics. The person who represents Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be 100% complete, meaning a complete human being. He does not make a sin. He does not sin. He does not make any mistakes. He's, you know, basically infallible and sinless, and does not commit any mistakes. He's flawless in any aspect of life. So he can represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and call the sons of Adam upon the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards paradise, and to take them away from the punishments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If this khalifa were to lie, if this khalifa was to backbite, if this khalifa was to drink, if this vicegerent and proof of Allah were to sin like any other human being, then it is not, you know, logical that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes His creations and the sons of Adam. Mm-hmm. So this proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has to be absolutely flawless. Mm-hmm. And it has to be from the time that the sons of Adam existed until the last moments before they perish, and the day of reckoning and the day of judgment appears, and the day of questioning appears upon man and the sons of Adam.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if we want to, some people, and sometimes they don't fully understand the explanation you just mentioned, but just to break it down, is that this same example you brought of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choosing the perfect creation to be His representative, it's like a president. You know, we're not comparing this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but no, we're breaking it down. Is that just a president of a specific country who rules his country based on democracy and based on, justice and love and compassion? He would choose the representatives that represent him in a way that proves, and in a way that show, that these people represent this leader. Hence, they have to be, and they have to obtain and sustain His qualifications or His attributes or characteristics. So if we want to go and, you know, further deepen the Quran, I know that there are a couple of narrations, a couple of verses from the Holy Quran which state, I mentioned one before the break, so if you can comment on that or comment inshallah on other verses that you have.
We'll get to that verse inshallah as well. Mm-hmm. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels to bow down or to prostrate towards Adam or to Adam, it was for one simple reason, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says that Adam is not as what you think. I taught him all the names, I gave him divine knowledge. Mm-hmm. I gave him knowledge that you do not know. For that reason, I am commanding you to make sujood towards Adam. Mm-hmm. That he has to be a complete individual. You know, not just a simple human being like you and I. Mm-hmm. This is one, when it comes to that verse. Mm-hmm. Also, when we go back to that verse, if we look into the word inna, inni ja'alun fil ardi khalifa. Inna, in the Arabic language, gives us recognition that, or ta'keed, to make assurance of something, that the word ja'il, that I am placing a vice gerent, is continuous, and it's because it's fi'l mudara, it's present tense. Mm-hmm. So if we go to the Arabic language, and those who understand the Arabic language, you will understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about the Khilafah in a continuous manner.
Yes.
And it wasn't just specialized in Adam. Alladhi, and through this word, you could understand al-istimrar wa dawam, that it's continuous and it's lasting from the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed Khilafah until the end of time. Mm-hmm. So when we look at these two verses, we see that it's not only specialized in Adam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the same position to David, Dawood alayhi afdal as-salati was-salam. If we go to the verse that you mentioned, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنذِرٌ وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that upon every nation, upon every group of sons of Adam, there will always be a person who guides them. Had, he's a guider and a guidance. And a mundhir. Mundhir is a person who comes and tells the people and the sons of Adam that this is not right. This is not right. He teaches them what's right and what's wrong. Them. He's a warner. He's a person that tells them to go towards the right path, towards the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. And you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to specialize it in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he would not have said وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ had.
Yeah.
He would have just said وَلِقَوْمِك, that you are, a guidance to your nation, yeah, or the nations of those before you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala generalized his verse that upon every single nation, upon every single community, upon every single generation, from the time of Adam until the day of judgment, that there will be a person who is had. He's a guider, and he's proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What I would like to ask right now, since that we have did mention that verse, which is verse 7 from chapter 13 of the Holy Quran, it testifies that there should be a guide for each time, for each nation. Now my question is, who is this guide today? I mean, you've mentioned Ibrahim, Adam, Prophet Muhammad, the various proofs, the various guides that the nations had. Who is the guide for our time? Doesn't that prove something?
Inshallah, we'll get into this. But before we get into that, I want to clarify that a person who is had as a guider cannot be a simple individual. For me, I need guidance as well. The greatest of scholars today, they need guidance as well. So it needs to be a person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a guide himself. Mm-hmm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him divine knowledge, divine piety, and divine ingredients to guide the sons of Adam. So it cannot be just a normal human being. And if we go to the hadiths of the Sunni heritage, we see that the hadith says المنذر, the person who that warned his people is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, والهادي علي عليه السلام, علي بن أبي طالب عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام. وفي كل زمان, and for every time, for every era, for every generation, there will be a imam that will carry this act of guidance, and he will be hadi and as a guider to mankind, and the sons of Adam, and as we have in the in through our traditions and hadiths, when it comes to this verse في تفسير هذه الآية, in the tafsir of this this verse, the hadith says, والله ما ذهبت منا وما زالت فينا إلا الساعة إلى الساعة. That this position was only given to us, and it did not leave from us, and it will not leave from us, Ahlul Bayt, the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, until the day of judgment. So saying that it stopped at the time of Imam al-Hasan al-Askari, this is also false when we look at the traditions of Ahlul Bayt alayhum afdal as-salatu was-salam, who they are, you know, the descendants of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. They are the immediate household of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and those who carried the divine knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just to go along with what you said, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a very nice quote which says, the stars are amnesty for the inhabitants of the heaven, and if they go away, in other words, become non-existent, the inhabitants of the heavens will be destroyed, will perish. And my Ahlul Bayt are amnesty for the inhabitants of the earth. Ahsant. And if my Ahlul Bayt go away, or Ahsant. An example, die, the inhabitants of the earth will destroy and be perished. So that goes hand in hand with what you're Ahsant. Mentioning right now.
There are many verses when it comes to this issue. Mm-hmm. Similar hadiths that the imams themselves, or the Prophet himself, explained his family to be the source of guidance. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi afdal as-salati wa salam says, وَنَحْنُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ عَلَى خَلْقِهِ وَبِنَا يَفْتَحْ وَبِنَا يَخْتِمْ وَنَحْنُ الْأَئِمَّةُ الْهُدَاتُ وَالدُّعَاتُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَنَحْنُ مَصَابِيحُ الدُّجَى وَمَنَارُ الْهُدَى. That we are the torches of guidance. We are the paths, the correct paths. Through us, people are guided. So if we want to see, you know, where to go and how to be guided, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and the imams, you know, illustrate to us that you go to anyone, to anyone besides them, you're being misguided and mistreated. Through them comes guidance. Through them, you know, the sons of Adam are placed on the divine path.
Mm-hmm. And through that, I mean, if we want to connect it, I know that we have a couple of minutes left till the end of the show, but through that, we find many verses that connect to that, and especially the hadith which Prophet Muhammad stated as his will. He says that if you do take these two worthy things and precious things into consideration, the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt, you'll never be led astray. And if we do take them, I mean, with this narration that I just mentioned, with the verses that you've just narrated and recited, if we do take those into consideration and ponder upon these words, we'll actually find and we will come to aware that these are the guided and the guidance towards the right path, and especially the one that we that have gathered us today, which is Imam Mahdi. May Allah hasten his reappearance.
Inshallah. So, you know, as you mentioned in the beginning of the episode, that for those who say, you know, the hadiths that are in our books, they're not enough for them to be proof that the Imam exists today. The verses that I mentioned are enough. Three verses through the Holy Quran that the Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has to be existent through every single generation, through every single time and era from the time of Adam until the time until the day of reckoning. And that it does not, you know, specialize in Adam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also addressed Dawood as the same, with the same name, being a Khalifa. So we understand that every single prophet and imam and representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a divine representative. Also, that every single nation needs a guider.
Definitely.
So, what differentiates us, our time, from those before us? Absolutely nothing. So, for those to come and say that we believe in his phenomena, we believe in him, but that he's not born, then you are contradicting, your words are contradicting the Holy Quran.
Definitely.
When the Quran says that this cannot be. Every single moment, every single second, there has to be a divine proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the universe.
Definitely.
Now, whether you see him or you don't, you know, if it's a cloudy day, but during the day, can we say, you know, the sun does not exist? No, the clouds are now being a barrier between us and the sun. But we cannot say, you know, the sun is no longer existing.
Definitely.
The sun exists, but today there is clouds and we cannot see them. And, you know, time will come when the clouds will go and the sun will reappear.
Beautiful example. That's a beautiful example.
And exactly the same thing with the Imam of our time. Today, and for the past 12 centuries, there has been a cloud upon our eyes due to our sins, due to tyranny, due to fact that if he were to appear today with all the injustice going on around the world, whether it's in Iraq, in the Middle East,
anywhere in the world,
in the West,
there's no country free of corruption.
They don't want, you know, today people are still not ready for a person to bring peace and tranquility throughout the whole world. You know, people don't care of justice today. When people start to care about justice, when people start to care about peace, when people start to care about one another, you know, we see that several days ago, the bombs in Baghdad shook the capital of this nation. So many children, so many kids lost their lives. But you see, none of the Western countries even, you know, gave you know, any attention to those who are losing their lives today.
Yes.
So yes, there is a cloud upon the eyes of every single human being today.
So inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove that cloud.
When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees people are ready, this cloud will be removed. And the sun that, you know, illuminates the path of every single human being towards justice, towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will be, you know, set upon us one again, once again.
Thank you very much for joining us, Sayyidina. We have come,
welcome.
Unfortunately, we have come to the end of the program. But as a conclusion, we can come to a conclusion, respected viewers. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. But respected viewers, we have come to the conclusion that Imam al-Mahdi is the connection between the heavens and the earth and is appointed by Allah as the intermediate for the rest of the creatures. His existence is always necessary, even if the time is not ready for his arrival and his outward appearance and the universal reconstruction that is him to bring about. So respected viewers, with this being said, and my dear guest Sayyid Muzaffar Al-Qazwini, who has joined me tonight, we have provided proofs and evidences of the existence of Imam al-Mahdi. May Allah hasten his reappearance. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Sayyid mentioned, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the cloud from in front of our eyes to see and to bless our vision with the appearance of our beloved Imam al-Mahdi. So thank you very much once again for tuning in. Stay tuned for tomorrow's episode. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you very much.